pretty genius picks and bans, and perhaps that might be pretty much the edge that they have, especially when they do have Uranus as well. Like, oh, look at how sick this is.
Look at that cinematic view. All right, that was woo. I am riled up already, and you can already see the control being exerted by Thorak, knowing that they have the stronger level one. They're going to try and push them out of and control that mid lane and as well as that river line. No invade. I don't expect Onyx to try anything, you know, too wowza to go for these big invades, but they control the mid lane. They quickly break it as quickly as possible, and they're looking to maintain that river dominance.
Now Chiku's going to be looking for a little bit of a chase. They are trying to actually contest for this little camp, and... Yep, they're going to receive a little bit of regeneration, so that's going to be great for CW and Co. And now moving in towards the jungle, of course, we heard about some changes in the jungle as well, as well as lane. So that's where you see parties have definitely shift on that sort of the early skirmishes. And seems like Antimage soaking a little too much.
Yeah, for Mezzi, making sure that any rotations or anybody trying to go for these smaller camps instead of the buffs as an invade, it's really good to stop them from it, especially in the earlier stages of the game, because even though the gold has been changed a little bit, the EXP hasn't, and getting to level 4 is the main objective for both of these teams, so I can definitely understand the plays, and the amount of priority is to control that river line.
Yeah, and I'm looking at all of these players, both Todok as well as Onyx Esports. They do respect each other's territory quite a fair bit, but looking at the side of Todok, they are looking for a dive, knowing that Antimage will be pretty much a hassle to deal with once he hits his level 4. Mm-hmm. But speaking of level 4, CW is already at it, and this is going to be a big concern here because X-Ray is going to make a move.
Yeah, he quickly is using his mobility with the Jeet Kune Do to get out of there, and it looks like they want to trade top turret very early on here, but I don't think they have just enough, they don't have enough damage yet, but Todok making the move here, trying to get the ejector onto Rassi, but he quickly flickers away. Whoa. But they do get the dominance ice onto Sasa. They get a catch up to CW. Now it's a 4v4. 4v5 not looking like a very good idea here as Anip tries to get out of the Steel Tempest. He gets knocked up almost instantaneously. Ling is going to be traded. That's actually not too bad of a trade considering what, considering who and the roles coming into that fight.
Yeah, I do think that it's pretty much even. If we even look into it, the goal graph, it's just very slight margins because of the first blood. But, you know, I would rather have CW being suppressed for a little bit, and it shouldn't have too much of a concern to get by much later on. Rassi's going to be regenning for a little bit, back in towards the response he goes. Well, it's just going to be the Battle of the Titans over the bot side.
Yeah, and it looks like, you know, Baxia is doing a really good job, especially with his Toys Poissons, allowing him to kind of negate the healing from Anti-Mage every single time he tries to use that Consecration. So it's a pseudo-counter, but again, we're talking about Uranus here, who doesn't really interact with the lane or the laner themselves, for the most part. Oh, this is a really big catch here. It looks like Anim just got caught out by the Fatal Lynx here. Moon coming in a little bit slightly late, and he's chasing Ling around, but he has just enough energy to bail on out. Moon's in a lot of trouble as he takes in quite a bit of damage from the Feather Airstrike. He's going to be going down. Boxy in the back line, he's completely trapped. He's probably going to be next on the chopping block as Esmeralda going through Riverside to make sure nobody helps him out. And yeah, he manages to walk away scot-free. Looks like Boxy does have enough toughness to keep himself alive.
I'm looking at that sort of engagement, which I felt was a little bit questionable. They kind of already lost a little bit of that sort of momentum right there already, and they still chased right in towards Onyx's jungle, which I felt wasn't really the wisest of decision, because you are at the same time losing some gold as well as EXP while on it. I feel like you can actually let go of that. Seems like a Blazing Duet will be used by Chiku just to get himself up above the rest. He's already level 8 and now he's looking for a pickoff already.
Yep, looks like Thorak wants to keep that control there. And you know, just because of that one death from CW, he's actually only level 7 while Chiku is level 9. So he is down. Technically, he should be very, very close to level 8. But overall, he's just a little bit down in EXP, and Chiku has been free farming this entire time. They haven't been able to punish him just yet, so he is going to come online very, very soon.
Well, in terms of resources, they're really putting all their eggs in one basket, but you know, with that sort of marksman being the beefiest unit of them all in terms of damage. So, of course, he should actually go in for a little bit of that contest, but seems like Onyx Esports will be able to actually secure the very first turtle of the MPL Invitational Four Nations Cup, but oh my! Seems like they did get a catch, but not the catch that they wanted. this is a whale if it's a fish in the ocean.
Dude, this is just like Uranus. This is just Uranus things. Only Uranus can do this, man. Like, nobody else can really just walk in and be like, I don't really want to deal with this guy, you know? And you can see even Mezzi is just like trying to get to his target. It's just like, oh, I have to deal with him. But he also is very aware that Ling is trying to take his target. He successfully does so, and Boxia, just unable to clear the wave or get even close to the tower, is unable to help.
And, of course, back towards the middle lane will be the focus of Onyx Esports as well. Of course, they don't really want to focus over the side of Uranus. Dream being brought down to 35%, and now Rassi is going to be chipped off for a little bit as well. But looks who's stuck. It's going to be CEW, but he does land his ult into its tree, and the Fatal Links will connect, but it will be one going down in the form of the Jawhead. And, well, pretty much a big trait, and X-Ray's pretty much caught up by himself as well. This is going to be the Turp member being brought down there. And, of course, Todak loses way too much out of that.
Yeah, Todak. It's really frustrating to see this fight go down because it shouldn't have begin in the first place. It's all dependent on Chiku. Look at that. Yeah. Ooh. Chiku is literally all of their damage. Everybody else from the side of Todak is just a punching bag for Onyx Esports. The amount of damage that Chiku can pull out is so much more. Even Sasa hasn't hit critical mass yet. And being down three levels against someone like Chiku, who already has the Demon Hunter sword, yes, it doesn't do as much damage as it used to. We get it. We totally get it. But it doesn't change the fact that once you have the Golden Staff, it's still a power spike. It's not as strong as it used to be, but it's still a power spike.
Yes, indeed. And speaking of a little bit of power, it seems like Animesh will be melted to 20%. But Chiku could not commit any further. But here comes the Lynx pulling it back. My goodness, beautifully connected onto two. And of course, Ling will get one as well. But Dreyens will suffer some hit at the back S. It seems like four mace will be assassinating him. Mm-hmm. And here comes CW once again. Three more members down for the side of Todak.
He cannot run away from this. And yeah, the moment Chiku dies, the rest of Todak just have to run away or stick together or figure some way out of this. And even though Chiku does have the Purify, how do you react to that? Rassi came in so quickly, preemptively using his ult and flickering forward to catch him off guard, to catch Chiku off guard. A really nice play. However, he's not going to be able to do that again for another minute and 2 seconds.
Yeah, and to add on top of that, Purify has definitely been nerfed, and yeah, this is rough. Like, seems like Toda has nowhere to hide inside their own jungle, but of course, payback time in terms of Animage. And, well, Feather Airstrike being released so far, they're going to be able to actually secure 2 to 3 towers already for the side of Onyx Esports. Now, gold definitely swings in favor for the Indonesian side, and this is the reason why everyone's been raving about this team.
Yeah, and you know, Onyx Esports, they feel like they found their stride, you know, with the addition of Rassi and Sasa. They've been really performing out of their minds ever since, you know, MPL Indonesia. Even in the playoffs, both Rassi and CW have made a significant impact for their team, which is really, really good for Onyx, who desperately needed, you know, a new flavor. And you can see that they're taking objectives rather easily now. There's nothing Todak can really do to stop them at this point of time. The rest of the members and the supports are so under leveled, except for Chiku, who's just been funneled this entire game.
Yeah, although they did funnel all the resources onto its the side of their marksman, it doesn't seem like he has pulled the trigger at the right time. There were fights that, you know, should have been there a little bit earlier, and with that sort of the dive attempt over on the side of Entomage, easily they could just actually do pretty much a recommitment coming in from the side of Onyx, but here comes a team fight.
This is the fight that we were looking for potentially, and it looks like Chiku, he's kind of hiding around, waiting for Moon to get the initial catch with the Jawhead. They chunk down Dreyens to half HP, but the rest of the team is in a lot of trouble. They're trying to dodge out and force out as many abilities as possible. You can already see Chiku, he's rotating back into the fight. This might be it. Oh. He has enough damage. He's chopping down Anti-Mage, and Sasa is next quickly with the Blazing Duel. Three members getting caught in a way, but nobody's dead just yet. He hasn't found the targets. Forced to take the battle mirror image all the way back into safety. That must be so frustrating for Chiku.
But it's actually a very beautiful attempt of escape coming from the side of Onyx. They knew what to do. They went in three separate directions and all of them survived, so it leaves him with a couple of options. Okay, I should go for either one of them, but you know, like, he was so close to actually melt all three. So yeah, it definitely feels really bad. So can't really say it's kill denied if you're almost there.
Yeah, it's so frustrating. Just look at everybody else. Like, Chiku is so well-fed while the rest of the team is just, like, starving away, hoping for the right time, hoping to utilize their resources and force out options from Onyx Esports, who already have acclaimed the Lord, and Mood, who is just sticking his nose to look for information to feed back into his team, gets punished once again, and these picks have significantly hurt them.
And of course, it will still hurt them even more so in the late game. There, the Hepsis is out, and Chiku's getting dove upon. All the members are trying to actually crush them upon all these sort of corners, and it will be a mega kill coming in for Sasa. Sasa has not been taken out as of now, but Anip, he's getting striked from right underneath his turret, and here comes Rassi. He's trying to actually connect the dots, and it will be Godlike coming in for CW on his 8th kill, and X-Ray forced to flicker away.
What a great bait coming in from Rassi here. He goes in with the least amount of HP you would have ever expected, and when he comes in, like, I was thinking, okay, he's going to use his ult, he's going to try and make a play and sacrifice himself. No, it's purely just to bait in Anip here at the very end, and he quickly flickers away out of skill shot range and allows the rest of the team to collapse on them.
And so, speaking of a collapse, seems like there might just be another collapse over the mid-side. Wither Dragon over the side of Andamage as they are trying to hold on for dear life. Formate's tanking it out, but the Boxer can only hold so much. But the Lord is hitting from the top side as well. They're escorting away from the mid-side while the bottom crashes in. Seems like there won't be any more turrets left for the side of Todak. And now, they are forced to actually re-engage. And let's see, Feather Airstrike being committed here with a legendary coming in for CW. He's looking for a double, and oh my, the dive and Blaze of Death has already been out, but it's so close to take down Rassi. Moon will fall down, and Onyx only loses one.
Unfortunately, it looks like Todak decided to sacrifice their members and not actually re-engage into the fight, which was what I was kind of expecting from Chiku here. Maybe heal up from the minions just a little bit, like bring him up to at least 65% HP before re-engaging into the fight, because I still think that fight was highly winnable considering that a lot of the cooldowns have been used very early on. Mm-hmm. And now Chiku trying to make the play onto Anti-Mage here, who is chunking him out. He's using his Battle Mirror image really, really well. However, whoa, when you're up against the likes of Sasa
so
as well, ooh, it's getting way too close, unfortunately. Sasa wasn't able to get that last bit of damage. Battle Mirror image came off of cooldown, and Chiku was able to kite him out. Nice play coming in from the marksman from Todak.
Yeah, I thought that Chiku would be a goner right there.
Oh, like, for sure. I thought he was dead.
The damage output was pretty absurd, if you ask me. But hey, he walked out of that, and of course, they did brought down Sasa as well, which was pretty much unkillable. So now they finally got a little bit more momentum going on, and Chiku was already hit max level. It's more about the rest of the teammates where they gotta get maybe a little bit beefier to help him absorb some damage before he dives in with that Blazing Duet.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I think Chiku can't just do this alone, but the rest of the team is just like so severely under-farmed that it's kind of hard to expect them to find these catches. And you can see that both X-Ray as well as Moon are doing their best to find options. And the easiest one has to be Anti-Mage, but he's also the hardest to kill for everybody else. And, you know, Sasa is still an absolute beast, so as long as he doesn't get caught out, he can kind of wait for everybody else to engage, like CW and as well as Rassi.
Oh no, they're actually chasing over on side of Chiku already as they are actually collapsing upon him. But of course, it will be Aurora locking them down at that choke point right there. And Onyx just forced to just be halted for a little bit more while they are looking for another new target. CW is on the hunt. They are diving all the way back.
Oh!
They do find Chiku,
oh!
Though, but they take him down. Immortality being popped. And now here comes the ultimate. And they will actually knock X-Ray up in the air before finishing him off.
Chiku needs to get back into this fight right now. He can actually get some free kills. And yeah, Anti-Mage is trying to bail out of there, but he can't go any deeper. Forward!
Whoa.
He gets launched backwards! What just happened? He tries to Blazing Duet to kind of kill off the rest, but that was not enough. As for Messi, coming right on in to push him forward. Oh my goodness, Rassi caught him off with the Fatal Links, even though he tried to use the Battle Mirror image. They're looking to end the game. The minions are running in. The crystal is gonna fall. Wow, that was such a weird looking interaction.
Yeah, like, so many back and forth going on, and that Fatal Links was the game-winning ultimate that they needed to secure this. That we are definitely in for another epic battle between Onyx Esports versus Todak once again. And now, if you guys have missed out.
Okay, all right, no worries. It looks like the game is still going on, which is the most important thing. We're not having to do any of those remakes. You guys are still gonna get your game.
And yes, indeed.
And it looks like it's going to keep on going. All right, no technical issues. All right, sweet. Let's go. Let's go. It looks like Dodak is making sure they keep control over the side lanes. And Boxia is actually winning this level one against Anti-Mage here because he's not allowing him to get any heal off with his with his Feast of Blood. So it's becoming, he has to wait till level two before he even stands a chance. So it's kind of interesting how that particular matchup works out.
And interesting rotation coming from 4maze as well. And now it's going to be a 2 versus 3. Well, 4maze might be able to actually soak in a little bit of damage, but he's stuck behind a wall, forced to flicker away, and Anti-Mage might just have this first blood in hand. Oh boy.
Yep, slow reaction coming in for 4maze. He thought he was going to be A-OK. He totally forgot about Anti-Mage rotating towards that side of the map. And now they're actually doing a bit of a lane swap here. They're getting the Export to go to the top lane and Thamos to go down to the bottom side. And you can already see the Esmeralda has kind of sniffed this out. It's like, what's going on here? Checks the entire river, doesn't see where Exborg went. And now he sees off the minions that the Thamos has kind of shown up. He'll take that River Crab for himself and hopefully secures it.
Yeah.
Oh no, he's pushed off.
This is looking pretty bad, and it seems to be a good snatch coming from the side of X-Ray, but he will falter instead. So I'm not too sure, was the crap really all too worth it?
Yeah, not exactly worth it here, but great utilization of the Granger ultimate there. That Death Sonata has some serious range. Like, the moment he got stunned, he was already hit by the slow from the Death Sonata. There was no means of escape for him there. And now they're going to do it one more time. They're going to try and harass this bottom side as much as they can.
Yeah, and of course, real great cover-up coming from Moon for the side of X-Ray as well. So they are just trying to actually receive and defend their turrets to the best they can. Seems like Sasa will be watching this one grabbed away, but oh my, Rass is coming from the back as well. But seems like it's going to be a little bit overcrowded here. Looking at the situation, it's going to be Todak here just re-rotating towards the mid side.
Yeah, they're just making sure that they're keeping their carry safe. They can't afford her to go too far, especially when, you know, middle is missing three members, Granger and the kill squad of Atlas as well as Selena. Very powerful combination, one CC and it could be over for you. Even getting caught by the Death Sonata might spell your death.
Yeah, I think that the damage output will be way too much to take in if that's the case. And it's going to be pretty much a long, hard fought battle right over the bottom side as we see X-Ray trying to actually stop that sort of a proxy going on, but oh my, here comes the pop of the health! And instantly the leads off Moon. There's not even a single chance for him. While E1 being dropped down low, which means that Onyx has pure security over on towards the first turtle of the game once again.
Oh, it looks like Chiku was able to get an initial kill onto Anti-Mage as well, so I guess that is some kind of retribution at the end of the day. But once Onyx gets this ball rolling, it's very hard to stop them from snowballing. We've seen them time and time again do this, and now Sasa on the chopping block as 4maze breaks his Firaga armor. That's very important because now they can set up a dive before he gets that Firaga armor back.
Yeah, and while they're at it, this is going to be really rough, and yeah, no chance at all, but Rass is going to be coming in, trying to actually connect the Fatal Links, brings E1 back, and this kill trying to be distributed towards the side of CEW, and that took long enough for that killing spree.
Yeah, they trade one for one, but that's not too bad. Sasa goes, oh, wait a minute, another catch downing on the bottom side, but Anti-Mage is playing this really, really well. His ultimate is keeping him alive, and Thodak, they just move away, wait for the cooldown, wait for him to use one of his ability, waste his cooldowns, and come back in for the final blow. And Mezzi trying to clear that way with the Tortoise Poissons, but that's nothing much when it's coming up against Onyx CW, where he's got literally every buff in the game stacked on him.
I'm not too sure if that was a wise move forward side of 4maze. After all, you know, he doesn't seem to be all too familiar with that sort of rotation that Onyx has been pulling up lately. And now, one more team fight breaks out over the midside.
Yep, and the midside is getting sucked back in the Fatal Links. And once again, Rossi making sure that they are picking off their supports. They're making sure that they are really, really weak in these stages of the game. And they are being extremely proactive, considering that Todak was supposed to be the ones being a little bit more proactive within this game.
Yeah, and I felt like they gave in a little bit way too much of that pressure. As we are looking at only 5 minutes, there's already 6 kills in the back, and yet another turret falls towards the bottom side. Drian tries to secure that camp for himself, but look at 4maze. We'll just respect a little bit of that sort of territorial control while there's another turtle up for grabs if they want to actually go for it. But, you know, there's still the pressure from the top lane, so Antimage is definitely going to go in for that push. So if they do commit to this, it might not end well for the side of Toda.
Yep, they're going for the invade as well, and the rest of the Toda members are getting chunked down one by one. Moon is using his feathered airstrike, but again, they've chunked them but not killed them just yet. Rossi's still alive. He refuses to go down to CW, just kiting them in the back. He has done so many rondos already to get on out of there. Sasa, he should be able to break it out, but the Faraga armor still holds strong as Bormaze trying to secure the kill, jumps over the wall, sees three members, and realizes this isn't worth it. That Faraga armor hasn't broken. Anti-Mage jumps right on top of Moon. Moon is unable to get on out of there. What an abyssal arrow coming in from Drian. Pinpoint accuracy.
That was such a perfect shot from the corner of the bush, and he was just baffled, stunned, unable to even move an inch. So now, with that sort of pickup, they have so much more room for perhaps some invasion towards the top side, and E1's getting caught out once again. This is going to be a monster kill going over the side of CW. Two games in a row, T's aiming for that double-digit KDA coming in this way, and hopefully another MVP title that's probably going to be coming in by the end of the game.
Yeah, and Sasa coming in with the last insanity, trying to chunk out Boxia as much as he can, but it's really not going to matter too much here in this particular situation, mainly because, you know, Onyx Esports, yes, they have a very good trigger finger. They know when to pull it, and every single time Todak has fallen into it without fail. Todak can't seem to fake Onyx out to waste resources without it being underutilized. Onyx, every time they press a skill, they press a button, they have a purpose, and they are looking to punish.
Yeah, and let's look into some itemizations right now. Of course, we got the BOD on the side of CW, and oh!
Once again, that's the trigger finger.
Yep, definitely pulled it at the right time, and that's a really great catch over side of E1. And you know, we expected the Kufra to do a lot from the early stages, but now here comes another catch over side of X-Ray. They are trying to actually disengage as Rossi gets picked off there, as the Esmeralda will go in for that chase. For Maze now going over on towards the corner, and he's running for his life already. That's a double kill going in favor of side of Toda.
Yeah, Chiku getting eventually run down by the members of Onyx Esports. Ah, unfortunate, but they trade again another one for one. That's not too bad, honestly, considering that Todak come up on top of that trade. So honestly, it's a bit of a win for Todak here, but Onyx Esports is going to hit the second item power spike, and that's going to be pretty devastating considering at what stage, 8 minutes into the game, Lord is coming up real soon after this turtle.
Now, of course, the turtle attempt will not be contested once again. Onyx really has a way to actually secure a lot of all these objectives pretty much fluently. They don't really seem to have any issues when they go in for any sort of commitment. So far, every single move that they have been doing has been pretty much very well calculated, which is why, you know, it's really hard when you are pretty much far behind in terms of goal.
Yep, and now they're going to keep on pushing forward or looking for some sort of advantage to give Chiku some space to farm. They break that top tier 1, and they're looking again. They look to stay for a little bit too long, and Chiku, he already recalled. I'm not entirely sure what the rest of the Todak is doing. Are they trying to recall? Wow. Are they trying to fake a fight? And even though they tried to fake a fight pretty well, they get caught out once again. Oh, Moon getting hit by every single shot of the Death Sonata have given the green light for Onyx to crush on down, and to take down these inhibitor turrets and look to end this game.
Of course, without minions, there's still no problems for the side of Onyx Esports. They are trying to actually look for another opening from the top side, but the minions are a little bit too far off, so they are heading towards the bottom lane for that. Well, there's going to be less than a minute before we see the spawn of the Lord. Maybe they might actually go in for that as well to perhaps close out this game itself. But Formase might just actually try his best to pull up some minions, but looks like we have another one.
Getting suplexed like that from Rossi is just nasty. Like, what else can I say about it? He got sucked in by the Fatalings, and the rest of the team just put him in the dirt. Like, there's nothing much I can say about Chiku and Moon. Once again, they've been caught out. Malefic Roar just being bought by CW. If they want to break that crystal, they can do it whenever they want at this point. And the rest of the Todak members are just trying to clear out that wave. Oh! For Maze, with all the items that he has, still unable to do much. Last Insanity jumping right on top of that Kufra. Next is going to be X-Ray biting the dust. And now, Onyx, they've dominated this match long enough. It's time to end it.
Yes, indeed. And now they're rushing all the way in. They want the very final blow. And here comes that suplex that we're talking about, baby, as we will finish off with two points for Indonesia. Onyx Esports secures the game.